We shall study God's word. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5, verses 31 to 32. And also we will refer to Matthew 19 for a short while. And that's a passage we read during the responsive reading from the scripture. As I said in the last message, I will take several weeks to cover this topic because there are several things that we have to deal with to fully bring about the essence of this message. Verse 31 and 32. It hath been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you, that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery, and whosoever shall marry her that is divorced, committeth adultery. By the way, I must tell you that I have to correct myself the way I pronounce the word divorce. Last week I've been saying divorce, divorce, divorce. And when I was listening to my own message, which I do every week, either on a Wednesday or Thursday, I asked myself, what am I saying? I keep saying divorce, divorce, divorce. Then I suddenly realized that shouldn't be the way to pronounce it. So I checked out and I was wrong. It should be divorce, whether it's American or UK, English, British pronunciation, it should be divorce. And then I said, where did I learn this? So I went around asking a few people in the church office and here and there. I realized the general pronunciation in Singapore is divorce. So now I know where I got it. I want to be conscious, try and say divorce, in case some people who listen to us from other countries wonder, what am I saying? So we are talking about divorce when we say divorce, right? Okay. So if I happen to have both coming up now and then, forgive me. I will try to keep it to the right one. Okay, so we talked a little bit about what God intends about our marriage. Last week, we realized divorce is not what God wants from us, but remain faithfully in the marriage. I said faithfully because you need to be faithful to God who gave you a spouse, and also you have to be faithful to one another, because the original plan of God concerning marriage is a man shall leave his father and mother and what? Cleave, never separate. That's what we learn from Genesis 2:24. Cleave, always cleave. Every day, every minute, you put effort to cleave to your spouse, not separating. Even when troubles come, even when conflicts come, even when there are disagreements, we are not trying to emphasize our point to separate ourselves. But we must try to emphasize our point, if we think that's right, in a cleaving way, in a way that bring us together. So don't enter into disagreements or difficulties by making the other feel pushed away from you. But draw the person to yourself and talk. Draw the person to yourself and debate if you need to convict the person. Do not use words and actions that push the spouse away. So the command from God is, leave from all else and cleave to one another and become one flesh. Unfortunately, man who has fallen into sin think that the best way to resolve unresolvable problems, as it might appear, constant problems, new problems constantly being added, is to separate from one another. So because of the existence of differences, difficulties, and problems, people think marriage cannot continue, and it is not good to be married or remain married. The best is to separate. So they say, well, if we are separated, then we don't argue, we don't fight, we don't have this animosity, we don't feel hardships, we don't have to be stressed all the time. If I'm separated, then that's it. I live for myself. He or she can live for himself or herself. We are separate, we are on our own. Ooh, peace. That's how we think. But you see, the relationships that God has granted to us, because of the presence of sin in this world, can never be maintained without struggles. No relationship with anyone, whether it's parent-child relationship, or husband-wife relationship, or relationship within the church among Christian brethren, or name any other human relationship, it can never be maintained without struggles, without fights, because there are issues within ourselves and around us that try to pull us apart. And there will be difficulties that cannot be resolved with human mind. You can debate on an issue, as people say, till cows go home. You won't resolve the problem. There's no way you can resolve all your problems. Sun would set. The bees will go to sleep. But your heart may be a raging sea. You still want to wake up from the bed, sit on the bed and fight. Don't want to go to sleep. So the Bible tells us in Ephesians 5, be angry, sin not, let not the sun go down in wrath. You settle your problems. Now, it doesn't mean settle your problems means you resolve all your problems, but settle down in your hearts, knowing that this is my wife, this is my husband, or this is my dad, this is my children, and I have to resolve my problems with prayer. But let me not create animosity. Let me not become hostile. Let me not make it difficult for both of us to live together. I don't think within a day we can solve all our problems. So if the problems exist, please do not think that we shouldn't exist together. Like an analogy I gave last Sunday. If you have a small problem with your finger, if there's an infection or a cut or some sort of problem, the pain will be very severe. So when you have a painful finger, would you cut off your arm? That would be crazy to do that. You try and take care of the problem. So in marriage, when problems arise, I want you to remember this. Our duty is not to resolve the problem by cutting off our marriage, but establishing the marriage by working together to resolve our problems through prayer, through analysis of God's word and application of the truth in our lives, and humble obedience to whatever God says. Now, divorce is a matter I'm not going to deal with even today. Because before anything can be said about divorce fully, I believe it must be understood what other things are involved in the matter of divorce. The next important thing, according to verse 32, that we need to look at is what is known as fornication or committing of adultery. Verse 32 says, I say unto you that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, meaning except, saving the old English word meaning except for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery, and whosoever shall marry her that is divorced or divorced committeth adultery. Well, fornication means sexual impurity. And that is the only cause that God says is legitimate to undergo a divorce. Now, what it means, how we should consider fornication as a legitimate ground for divorce, we will talk about it, God willing, next time when I come back. But let's talk about this matter of sexual impurity. Fornication. This is very, very significant. Now, we know that the scripture is absolutely clear that God wants purity in our lives. Jesus already said it. We studied that a few weeks ago when Jesus confronted the Pharisees about their idea of adultery. And Jesus said, watch your eyes, isn't it? Do you remember that? Look at verse 28. Let's remind ourselves. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her, that hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. So looking at a woman in a sensual way leads to impurity, sexual impurity. So you see, we have to go into our hearts. We got to deal with our eyes. We have to understand adultery is not an external matter. Sexual impurity is not just an external matter. It doesn't begin externally. It begins within us, within our hearts and minds. And that's where the work must begin. And one must understand that God is extremely concerned about this. I want you to turn with me to the book of Exodus, chapter 20. We're going to look at some very interesting commandments and stipulations from the Lord. And in verse 14 of Exodus 20, we read, thou shalt not commit adultery. A very brief statement. A solid, non-negotiable, firm shout from God. Thou shalt not commit adultery. It stops every man on his stride. It stops every man in his thoughts. Even in this worship such as this, God's word is to us all, stop your adulterous mind. Just because you are dressed up and sit very comfortably in an honorable way on the seat, it doesn't mean you are not adulterous in your mind. Let this always ring in our hearts and minds. The Lord's command. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Look at verse 17. He elaborates under another commandment that says, thou shalt not covet. And he explains that in this way. Verse 17, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Absolutely clear. In the midst of coveting, being greedy, the Lord says, don't be greedy for another man's wife, including his maid. Why would you be greedy for another man's wife but for sexual exploitations? You want to know how serious this is? Let's go to the last part of this chapter. I'm going to read verses 25 and 26. This is about worship. And if thou wilt make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone. For if thou lift up thy tool upon it, if thou hast polluted it, neither shalt thou go up by the steps unto mine altar, that thy nakedness be not discovered thereon. It's a very profound teaching from the Lord concerning how Israel should come before God in worship. I won't understand all the details. I don't think I can give you an answer to every question that might come in your mind. But you must not miss the point that the Lord is saying here. He said to the Israelites, when you build my altar, don't build it up on the top of a pyramid kind of situation where you have to climb up the steps. And the reason that you will not expose your nakedness on it. In those days they wear the long robe. And if they were to climb the steps all the way up to the altar and stand on it, their nakedness will be seen on the altar as though somebody is lying on the steps and looking up and seeing your nakedness. Now that at least tells you how God views the way we think of others' nakedness. It has no place when you come to worship. God's worship requires a sanctity that is not even conceivable in our fallen mind. It's so obvious. The Lord said in verse 26, neither shalt thou go up by steps unto mine altar, that thy nakedness be not discovered thereon. Today, Christians, the way they dress is shameful to say. Well, we don't believe in legalism. I'm not going to measure how long is your skirt, how well you covered your nakedness, or how much of your flesh is exposed. I'm not going to do it. But I preach clearly many times over. Do not dress to attract men's or women's eye to yourself and your flesh. Don't be a reason for distraction. Even in the church, I want to be a little clear about this. Even in worship time, there are women who come with utter disrespect for the holiness that God requires. They come to show off the flesh. They know the pastor preached time after time The Bible is clear. Modesty is our business. Chastity, holiness is our pursuit. Not carnality, not exposure of our skin. Lift up your arm, man must turn your eye away. As loose as possible, exposing your undergarments. You come up to the stage to sing, the pianist to play the music. They've got to dress properly. It shouldn't be a reason for distraction in God's presence. You can argue, but I hope you understand there's no argument before God. Absolutely no argument. You see, the extent of the adultery that exists in our society, in our homes, in our mind, is seen in the way we dress. The way we think about God and put ourselves as worshipers of the Almighty God. You know, my dear friends, some people have this statement. Go to church modestly, but after that it's okay. As though your God is dead elsewhere. As though he's non-existent. As though he only watches us only from 10:30 a.m. on Sunday to 12:30. And after that, we are free to do what we want. This is of utter importance that no one climb the steps and expose the nakedness. You know how shameful this can be? Would you turn with me to 2 Samuel? I'll show you something here, very interesting. It's a terrible thing that the world has done. How God's servant David responds to it. 2 Samuel chapter 10. And in verse 4, we read of a man called Hanum. Wherefore Hanun took David's servants and shaved off the one half of the beards and cut off the garments in the middle, given even to their buttocks, and sent them away. When they told it unto David, he sent to meet them, because the men were greatly ashamed. And the king said, tarry at Jericho until your beards be grown, and then return. You know what is this all about? Humiliating a person. Humiliating godly people. And the wicked ones knew how to do it. When they got hold of David's servants, the first thing they did was to take away the manliness. In the Near East, men would normally keep the beard in those days because they had lots of beard. Some Asians do not have that much beard as they had, so we don't keep. But in those days, manliness was seen in the mustache and the beard they have. And that was... It was embarrassing to shave off half of their beard and leave them alone. And that's not the only thing they did. They even did much more despicable thing. They cut their clothes in the middle. From the top down, half of the body was exposed up to buttocks. But from there, it covers only the top part of the body up to buttock. But even that was a shameful thing. And they dare not come back to God's people's dwelling place. They were so embarrassed. So David said to them, now don't come home wait until your beard grow, put on the proper clothes and come. That's what he meant. Now that tells you how God's people used to think about nakedness. Today, I had to really plead with brides how they dress on the wedding day. Most of the time, they have bare back. The rest I don't want to describe. And I thank God for our young ladies who take heed. He said, you don't come before God's presence for blessings with bare back, causing the rest of the guests sitting behind you to have sensual thoughts all through the service. And then I have to raise my hand and bless you. It's very difficult. You got to have a thought for me too. I'm a man. Whoever is the preacher, they also don't want to see your nakedness, even in a suggested way. It's a time of great sanctity and solemnity. We are God's people. I do not want to make my children put on something that exposes the body. I tell my wife, I tell my daughter, be careful. I tell my boys also. I sometimes feel upset with my kids because they just dress like the rest. They say, I'm not going for church. I'm not going for youth fellowship. Or I'm only going for youth fellowship. Why not? I said, no, please, be careful. But today, most Christian parents themselves live shamelessly, causing every impetus that is needful for adultery. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 18. Leviticus 18. This is a chapter that is so explicit about the wickedness of carnality that exists among men. And the Bible says no, 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 no to all of it. I'm going to read from verse 5. Ye shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man do, he shall live in them. I am the Lord. I am the Lord. He says, I am sovereign. I'm your God. I've called you, made covenants with you. And so you better walk in my judgments. And then he goes on to say, none of you shall approach to any that is near of kin to him to uncover the nakedness. I am the Lord. Don't get close to any relatives. Maybe your cousin or nephew or niece to uncover. Well, now you say, then how about I clean up my young nephew who is so young. I see his nakedness because I, you know, he dirtied himself and I want to clean it. No, this is not about cleaning a poor baby who is helpless or helping a young man who is sick and bedridden, can't do anything, and you attend to him. This is not the point. The point is you uncover him to look at it. You peep, or the peeping tones. Or you find ways. How shameful are the people of our generation? They use their mobile phones to take upskirt videos. They hide it in toilets. They put it in places where they can really uncover the shame of people. And it is done by both men and women in these days. It's dangerous. The relationships that we have in our families are not to pacify our carnal desires. Read on. Verse 7. The nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother shalt thou not uncover. She is thy mother, thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover. In other words, if your mother passes away and your father remarries, you do not then uncover the father's wife. It is thy father's nakedness. The nakedness of thy sister, verse 9, the daughter of thy father, it may be a stepdaughter. In other words, you may be the child of the first marriage, and the father married again, and then you have a half-sister. And even that is mentioned. The nakedness of thy sister, the daughter of thy father, or daughter of thy mother, whether shall be born at home or born abroad, even the nakedness thou shalt not uncover. You may not have seen your half-sister for a long time because they were elsewhere. You grew up in one place, your half-sister lived in another place, and you finally see one another. Please, don't be carnally motivated. Again, verse 10. The nakedness of thy son's daughter or of the daughter's daughter, your grandchildren, old men, take care. There are a lot of dirty old men in these days. Even rape the grandchildren. We see such news in the newspapers in these days. It's horrible. Let every person, even aged, take care. The nakedness of thy son's daughter or of thy daughter's daughter, even the nakedness thou shalt not uncover. For thus is thine own nakedness. You know, you embarrass all these young ones, you're embarrassing yourself. Verse 11. The nakedness of thy father's wife's daughter, begotten of thy father, she is thy sister. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's sister, your auntie. She is thy father's near kinswoman. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy mother's sister, for she is thy mother's near kinswoman. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's brother. Thou shalt not approach to his wife. She is thine aunt. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy daughter-in-law. She is thy son's wife. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy brother's wife. It is thy brother's nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of a woman and her daughter. Neither shalt thou take her son's daughter or her daughter's daughter to uncover her nakedness. For they are her near kinswomen. It is wickedness. Neither shalt thou take a wife to her sister, to vex her, to uncover her nakedness, besides the other in her lifetime. No polygamy, in other words. No polygamy. Also goes on to say, thou shalt not approach unto a woman to uncover her nakedness as long as she is put apart for uncleanness. Well, the uncleanness refers to several things. It can be ceremonial impurity. It can be moral impurity. A woman may be kept away for her wicked life, sensually wicked life, and you don't go and choose such a woman. Well, all of these that we just read are God's commandments as to how we approach the issue of sexual purity. The stress is not just the act, but even the desire to watch the nakedness of one of the opposite sex. However, we live in a world where we often find ourselves buried in nakedness. of the people. Women have no shame to take off their clothes and pose for photographs, suggestive photos, and they put it in magazines, and Christians go and spend their hard-earned money to look at these women and buy the magazines and hold them very proudly. They go and spend the money to buy the DVDs, to watch the movies. Men and women equally lost. And they spend the money to buy clothes that would cause others to think sexually about this person. Why should I spend money to make you carnal? Why should I use this God-given body to make you wicked? Why not our Christian women think this way? Why not our Christian men think this way? As the father of my household, it is my duty to make sure I tell my wife, tell my daughters, and if God willing, if I have a son and his daughter, to tell them, look, my daughter-in-law, I meant, please, dress up properly. I'm not here to see your skin. If you think that you can stop incest, if you think you can stop your husband from falling into your daughter-in-law's hand or the other way around, you're wrong. If you don't keep to the stipulations God gave, the chances are great wickedness would happen within our houses. And it would be very quick. We know why it's going to be very quick. Because that's what the world wants. Free sex, they say. We don't want to be bound to one person by marriage. We want to enjoy. They are like animals. And they think they are an upgraded version of modern beasts. So they want to behave like beasts. Where would we find the end? You know, one of the main reasons for divorce in these days is fornication. Suspicion, doubt, innuendos, suggestions. I know of a marriage that split apart because the man kept his close colleague's photograph in his mobile phone. And it is a lady colleague who is his secretary, works very close with this lady. He takes care of this lady because she is a businesswoman. She sells well. She brings in a lot of money for him. So he kept taking photos, go out for makan or food, sit together, take photo. Everywhere take photo. And she looks extremely worldly, carnal. That's how she sells a product, by exposing her body. She's a good saleswoman. Shorter skirts than the wife. Sleeveless, spaghetti hive. Exposing her own shame. And his mobile phone is full of this stuff. And the wife picked it up one day because he was having a shower and the phone was ringing. She went to answer. And the first photo came up because when this lady calls, the picture comes out. Because nowadays, the softwares are designed in that way. And that was a bad picture. It's not that she was naked, but the way she posed was as though suggestive. And that started an unstoppable quarrel. Ended up in divorce in a Christian family. Silly behavior. Why did I say silly? Because no regard for God's truth. I can tell you, even though I preach a sermon as clear as this, some of you will still be immodest in your dressing. You will ask, what's wrong? My mother did that. My grandmother also wore like that. My grandpa was like this. So why cannot? Oh, I know an elder is like that. That church elder's wife is like that. What does it matter? If they don't want to change, they don't change. But how about you? I want to say a word to all the married women here. You want your husband to be holy? You first be holy. And I want to say a word to all the men. You want to be holy? You better conduct yourself in holiness. If you are holy, why do you worry? And I also want to tell all the parents, the way you dress, the way you walk around, will also teach your children. And they are going to get worse than you. You now say, oh, this is okay, acceptable, when it is not modest. And wait until what your children tell you next time. You'll be gone. My greatest concern today for families in our midst is not the lack of finances they have. It's not lack of education they may have. It's not that they don't have cars to drive. It's not that they have to struggle a lot to go through life. No, I'm not afraid. I don't cry over these things. Even when somebody says to me, Pastor, I lost my job, I don't really fast and pray for them. I would just pray, Lord, be merciful to them, because by God's grace, we are all taken care of. And after all, the Bible says it's not easy to live on this earth. It's by the sweat of our brow that we earn our living. And so it's nothing wrong about it. If a young lady says, Pastor, I'm pregnant, I'm having all these kind of problems, I don't get unnecessarily worried about it. I will give them some advice and tell them this is what pregnancy is all about. It is in pain that God said you will conceive and give birth to children. So I'm not worried about these things, because if you trust God, these things will only give opportunity for you to know greatness of God, goodness of God, and you become stronger. But you know, the moment I see immodesty, carnality, this loose attitude toward the weird behavior of the world, accept it, my heart breaks. I know it is this close that a family is living in disaster. What do you watch? What kind of movie? You sit with your wife and watch immoral stuff. You take your children to watch these wicked things of the world, where they speak lightly of adultery and fornication, and you turn on the TV and watch. Nothing wrong about TV. I also watch quite a bit of TV, and there are things that are good. But, you know, all these stories of men falling in lustful affair with women and young people wickedly behaving, even children's cartoons, they are so horrible nowadays. They make them wear all kinds of things and appear before children. Some little girls look so sensual. The kind of songs they make them sing. You know, nowadays they have all kinds of, reality shows, such as what, Britain Got Talent, or Singapore Got Talent, or American Idol, or blah, blah, blah. You know, sometimes little kids will come and sing. You listen to some of the songs they sing. Because they got good voice control, because they can sing well, they let them sing songs of adult themes. And the little 3-year-old and 4-year-old or 6-year-old sing as though they are in desperate love with another woman or another man. And you look at the passion on the face, the postures they strike, the move. The little innocent ones are taught to be adulterous in behavior. Oh, the wickedness of this world. Do anybody feel ashamed about it? No. You are a proud generation, self-confident. We know what we are doing. We have grown up. We are matured. No wonder you are so matured until you cannot even keep your families together. How can our generation confidently say, we are matured people. We know what we are doing when their own families are breaking down. Husbands and wives cannot love one another. Children are abandoned. They get caught in situations where they don't know how to live and be loved and to love others. Is this maturity of our generation? A young man recently asked me a question, Pastor, in my school I had so much problem. I don't know how to deal with these issues. They say, what kind of religion you believe? Oh, your Bible says you stone children to death. Isn't it brutality? Isn't it violence? The poor boy was so troubled by such a depiction of the Bible. So I had to sit with him. I need to talk to him more and explain things even more. I said, you know, God didn't say cast stones at every child. God didn't say cast stones on every disobedient boy. God said, if they don't obey, if they don't repent, if they don't humble themselves, but continue to live a defiant life, ridiculing the Father, cursing the Father, then stone them. And you know why the world thinks it's a bad thing to do? Because they don't see the severity of sin. To them, defying the parents is okay. Cursing the dad is okay. Father is nothing. He's just another man. I'm an adult. I'm as tall as my dad now, so I can talk anyway. But if you do that defiantly without repentance, God said, kill them! And if you think God is unjust, you're wrong. He will never mete out a punishment that is not equal to the gravity of sin. You better understand this. We live in a world where definitions of sin have changed. Definition of morality has changed. Understanding and perception of what is good and what is bad have changed. What is right and wrong have changed. What is righteousness and what is sin also changed. And this is a problem not only out in the world, right within our churches, right in our families. Do you understand that there is nakedness within our families? You say, oh no, you know, what's so big? I'm at home. I wear these mini shorts, looks like undergarments. Mothers do that because they say, I'm at home, I'm working. You go to office or so you work. Why must be so exposing in the house? Ask yourself. We don't have any standards in these days. If you want to have a standard, give up your worldly thinking, get back to the Bible, there you have it. When you dress yourself as a mother, as a father, in a proper way, and conduct yourself, your children immediately pick up, all right, there's a way I should conduct myself. There is standard of righteousness. There is a way God wants me to put on clothes. There's a way I must talk. There's a way I should show respect. Everything is cultivated at home. Did you look at the list of the things we read in Leviticus 18? The context of all of it is home. Home. But today, to be very frank with you, in most houses, including Christian homes, what I see is that there is too much nakedness. Now, I know some people are going to throw stones at me for this. I'm very aware. But my dear brothers and sisters, my duty is to preach God's word as it is. It's your duty to decide how you want to respond. Choose you this day whom you will serve. And that's all I want to say. I didn't write these things. God did. And he is not unkind. He's not ungracious. He's not wicked as others are. Our God is good and gracious. His commandments are good. And there is no better way to safeguard ourselves and our souls and our children and our families and our church than taking heed to his word. We all come from different kinds of cultures where we have never been ruled by God's word. And so we just carry on that way. But if you carry on the way that you walked, as Paul says, in the vain traditions of your fathers, then you cannot glorify God. We can no more live in the vain traditions of the world. Even though our fathers followed that, we must change. My father might have been a drunk. My father might have been an adulterous person. No, not my father, all right? I'm just putting it as a supposition. You may say that, you know, oh, my father had two wives, so I can have three wives. No. No way. The lot of problems have crept into our families because we ignored God's word. And now I hope, if you want to avoid divorce, if you want to avoid family breaking up, take note what fornication is. It doesn't begin just in an affair with another person. It begins at home, in the way we think about our exposure of body and the way we respond to it. God wants sacredness. God wants sacredness in our homes and in our hearts. When that is established, then of course you will follow through with that. I want to tell you, the world doesn't know how to fix your marriage. You know, I'm a justice of peace as a solemnizer. Often I get updates from ministry forgot the name now, the government offices, in other words. Often I get letters. And they would tell you, come and attend this course, come and attend that seminar. They give me packages full of counseling material. Sometimes I flip through and take a look at it. You know, they will ask you to visualize. They ask you to try this principle, try that principle. And I just tell myself, why are they so desperate? Every year they come up with a package, but it gets worse. And then come up with another package. It gets worse. It's not getting better. What's the problem? Is it there's a lack of so-called counselors? Is it because there's a lack of education in our society? What is the problem? Is it lack of money? I mean, tell me why families disintegrate. Can you tell me? Why is this problem now a Christian problem? I think it's very important you understand, at least with regard to the way I have seen the importance of God's word in marriage has moved me to spend hours and hours and hours with young people who are going to get married. Normally, my sessions would take, one session would take about 1.5 hours to 2 hours. In some cases, you ask the young adults in our midst who have gone through, sometimes even take 3 to 4 hours. I don't run through. I don't charge them a cent for what I do for them. And that's not only one session. Normally about 6 to 7. And you times them with 2 or 3 hours. That's how much I spend just before the marriage. And even then I feel sometimes, you know, they just go through it because they want Pastor Koshy to solemnize it. But I always end up by saying, you know, you got a problem next time after marriage, and when you come for my help, I will tell you to go back and read the notes I give you and just practice what I taught you. Start it again. There's nothing new for me. Nothing new from me. It's again, go back to the basics. Go back to the basics. What basics? The God who created man and woman, ordained marriage, and told you how to protect your families from the incursion of fornication that leads to breakup. You understand? May God help us. May God give us the grace to think wisely, that we will not try to be smarter than God. When God says, put on your clothes, you do it and behave that way. The only place, as I said last week, nakedness is allowed is just between the husband and the wife, in the confinement of the bedroom. Once they're out of that place, wherever they go, they better put on clothes, because others are looking. There's one woman who told me, my husband has no problem. Why is it that you have so much problem? I tell you, I want to run when people talk to me like that. And one lady said, it's none of your business. I cannot say anything. I understand it's not my duty to counsel somebody else's wife. It's his duty. But as a pastor, I have a burden also, isn't it? It's not my duty to tell your daughters, fathers, let me tell you, it's not my duty to tell your daughters how to dress in your house and outside. It's your duty. And if I tell your daughter, this is not how you should dress, you will come and confront me and say, who are you? I didn't give you the authority to be my daughter's father, you know. I am dead scared at times the way people would react to me. And that I do not fear. I'm scared at I don't fear. You understand? You don't. Never mind. I am sincerely scared even to preach this message. But God gives me grace to be strong. I didn't consult anybody to preach this except my God. Young girls, young boys, when you go out for courtship, respect one another. You are not married yet. Don't behave like married people. What happens if you die? And the poor girl or the poor boy to live in shame that you have abused and mistreated that person. Let us not leave this church with people who are abused by our carnal appetite. Don't walk around in this world as a temptation. We are Christians. In us worketh a sanctifying spirit. In us there worketh a passion for the Lord's glory. Let us come and worship Him as a holy people. Our name is a holy nation, a royal priesthood. Our dressing, our acting, our behavior must be holy. Let's sing our final hymn by rising and turning to hymn number 368, from every stormy wind that blows.